My little pumpkin isn't really quite so little anymore. It didn't take very much to get this thing going. I planted it. You saw the shot of it when it was just a baby, not more than, what was it, a couple weeks ago. And what I did is I just dug a hole and I planted it with some of the compost in my compost pile. You can see the compost right there. And it just went nuts. It grew up. I had this little itty bitty fence around it. I had to expand the fence, and no, this is not going to contain this pumpkin. This will contain the pumpkin for a few more days. It literally grows by the day. You can almost watch this thing grow. Now, what it's going to do is, as pumpkins grow, certain parts of them touch the ground. They send down more roots. So your pumpkin will actually get stronger and stronger as it grows. Now, I'm going to step inside here. I want to show you something for those of you who may not know. Well, here I am inside. I wanted to tell you about something. Pumpkins, watermelons, cucumbers, vine squash, and zucchini. There are probably more, but those are just the basics. I gotta close that fence. Yeah, that popped open. Rabbit's gonna come in here and chew the heck out of these things. Can't have that. Okay, I'll remember to do that after I film this segment. But all of those plants that I mentioned, they have what's called male and female flowers. Most plants, they have flowers that have the male parts and the female parts on. If you don't know what that is, please consult your parents, because I'm not going to give you a sex ed discussion here. But they do have, I was just kidding. Most flowers have male and female parts, and they can pollinate themselves or pollinate other flowers on the plant. Whereas the ones I mentioned, they're different. They have what's called male flowers that cannot pollinate themselves, and they have female flowers that cannot pollinate themselves. So what happens is, generally, this is only generally, there are exceptions all the time. And generally what the plant will do is it'll put out male flowers first. And my theory is, the plant is sending out feelers, and it's sending out these male flowers to let the pollinators know, hey, I'm ready. The pollinators start showing up, and shortly afterwards, the plant puts out the female flowers. And the reason they put out the male flowers first is because they cost less energy to put out. And I'm going to show you why. No, that's not why. That's just rascal. Here at the base is what's called a male flower. All it is a flower with a thin stem attaching it to the plant. Here is another male flower. That's how you can tell the male flowers. They usually come out first, and I don't mean first in line on the plant. I mean they're the first flowers put out. And these flowers are actually quite beautiful. Look at them. They have little pokey things here. They're not sharp. They're kind of bendy, but they're actually beautiful flowers. And by the way, these flowers are edible. You can have them in salads. You can batter, dip them, and fry them. They're absolutely delicious, nutritious, and no, they are not poisonous whatsoever. Every part of a pumpkin plant is edible. It may not taste good, but it won't poison you. Now, I'm going to swing over to my left. I'm not kneeling down holding the camera. I'm trying not to make you seasick. Now, as soon as the male flowers come out, there are exceptions. Sometimes you'll get the females first. That means your plant's just a little bit special. But normally, they'll put out the males first. Now, here is what's called a female flower. This flower was open yesterday, and it closed up. But here's what a female flower looks like. It'll have a little bulb of fruit behind the flower. Yeah. And there's another one right over here. There's another female flower that opened up days ago. Now, what'll happen is the female flowers will open up, and you'll have pollinators that'll go from the male flowers to the female flowers. If you're a little bit paranoid, or if you want to be very sure that you're going to get pollination, all you have to do is get some pollen from the male flower, touch it with your finger or a Q-tip or something, and then touch the female flower. Or, if you're like me, I pick the male flower, and then I pull the petals off, and then you can see the inner parts inside, and that's what this is. See? You can see the parts in there. That way you can get at it easier. You take the petals off, and that way you can move this little guy around inside here, and you can go over to the female flowers and stick it in there, and you can pollinate the female flowers to make sure that they're getting pollinated. Now, the flowers will close up at night, so be very, very careful. I'm going to swing over again. Sorry for the shakiness. Now, the flowers do close up at night, and the flowers are usually only good for 1 to 2 days. Now, you want to make sure you're very careful if you ever... Now, once the flowers close up on a female flower, she's done. Okay? She's not going to take pollen anymore. The flower's old. But you got to be careful if you're taking the flowers off, because sometimes bees get trapped in there overnight. Yeah, you open it up and you're like, ah! So be very, very careful, okay? Anyway, the same thing goes with cucumbers. A female cucumber flower will have a little baby cucumber behind it. And they will generally grow cucumbers, whether they're pollinated or not. But if you get a cucumber that's kind of bent, that means that the pollen, it wasn't very well pollinated, okay? So you want to pollinate them a little bit better if your cucumbers are coming out a little bit bent. That doesn't go for watermelons and pumpkins, only for cucumbers. Now, the same thing goes with zucchini. You can pollinate the male and female flowers, and you're more than likely going to increase your chance of getting production off of these things. That's just my little tip. And by the way, your leaves normally don't look this crappy, but then again, you normally don't have crazy thunderstorms hitting you in the afternoon. And that concludes my story of how babies are made. For more information, please consult your mom and dad. Hey, you guys are following me everywhere, aren't you? I wanted to give you an update because I'm so proud of this. This I showed a few episodes ago. This is my little teepee, my little support structure for the Rapunzel tomato that I'm growing this year. A lot of you are growing Rapunzel tomatoes, and that makes me happy. My challenge this year, and I do like a challenge, is that I was going to grow a Rapunzel in a 5-gallon container, which really isn't a lot of soil when it comes to tomatoes because they can have really extensive root systems. I grew this one, for those of you who are new, I grew this one from a seed, and then as it got bigger, I put it in larger and larger pots. And then when it got just so big, I planted it at the very bottom of this 5-gallon bucket. And as it grew, I put in soil so that it would put out roots along the buried stem as it grew. This was inside. When I brought it out here, it wasn't a very tall plant. My challenge was to grow it in that size of a container, and this is up against cinder block and it has cement down here. This is a very common way for people to grow, is on patios, porches and stuff. And I wanted to see if it would grow with that kind of heat in that kind of a container. And it's been doing pretty good. The thing about this I want to tell you is when you grow in containers like this and you're growing a tomato, especially a tomato, you have to water quite often. Make sure that the soil does not stay dry for too awful long. Let it dry out between waterings, but not too awful much. Turns out, I've been having to water this every single morning because it gets really hot. This gets a lot of sun over here, and that's okay. And the bigger it gets, the more drain it has on the root system. And also, one last thing, I want to make sure that you understand this so that if you want to try this, it also sucks the life right out of that soil. Tomatoes and potatoes are two plants and corn that will drain the life right out of your soil because they are what's called heavy feeders. They really do need a lot of food. So what I've been doing is the compost tea that I make indoors for my indoor plants, I've been making that up extra strong, and I've been feeding this the compost tea. That's all it's been getting to eat. Now what it's doing is it grows out, and I'm training the vines, the tomato vines, to come out. And I also added a couple more poles out here because it started to get wider than just this little pyramid thing. So I added extra poles. These are all bamboo tied together with string. And what I'm doing is I'm letting it come out, and then it goes up the sides over here, and the middle ones come up the sides, and they're all going to come up to the top and then just flow over, basically in Rapunzel fashion, the way that her hair just trellised down. Now, the reason this is called Rapunzel is because it puts out these long trellises of flowers that turn into tomatoes. They say that you can get hundreds, but I've never seen them in real life get hundreds. But what it does do is it puts out a lot of these trellises all over the place. This one is ripe, a little red tomato, and they are sweet. That's one thing about Rapunzel. They put out sweet, delicious tomatoes, and a lot of them. So if you like sweet tomatoes, give Rapunzel a try. And you know what? I'm going to do what I did last year. Last year, I grew her in a really large pot, and she put out so many tomatoes, I saved the seeds, and I gave them away in my 2017 free seed giveaway. I'm going to do the same again. And I have so much confidence in her that I'm going to save her seeds. And those of you who didn't get to try this, or you want to try this, and also for the new people, or the ones that grew it last year and they like it and they didn't save enough seeds, I'm going to offer these seeds in the 2018 free seed giveaway. So stay tuned for this. I want you to see what this can do with no special treatment, no magic, no crazy weird powders or potions or fertilizers, just good old-fashioned quality soil. This is potting soil, by the way. Those of you who don't know, some of you know this, so this is old, a rerun for you. But for those of you who don't know, I just use standard potting soil. And it wasn't brand new potting soil. So this really didn't have any nutrients that potting soil normally comes with. This is old used potting soil. And I feed it with compost. And I don't use regular compost. I just use compost tea. So it's a liquid fertilizer that feeds the soil, that feeds the plants. So this is surviving off of nothing but compost tea. And that's doing pretty good. So this is something that you can do on your patio. I wanted to show you Rapunzel. Now let me show you a picture of this when I first brought it out, because we had a windstorm and it just really made this thing look at what this thing looked like when I first brought it outside. Take a look at this. It was kind of sad. And in just, let's see, that was, I think that was in the end of April or something like that. And in just weeks, I think it was a month or so, this is what's been happening. Now, it takes its time to get going. And what's happening now is she's putting out more and more suckers as it goes. So she's grows like a pyramid effect. And that's what we're having here. We're having more and more go out. So as she goes, she's going to have more and more stems, which means more and more flowers. There's no end to the amount of flowers on this thing. If you want a productive plant, Rapunzel is definitely the one for cherry tomatoes. That's what these are, cherry tomatoes, and they're very, very delicious. Boy, is it sunny today. I like coming down here. In the mornings when it's just a little bit cool and there's dampness on the grass, I come down to the Lower Uncton Garden, and this is on the east side of my property. And there's no trees to give it any kind of shade. So if I want to grow something that requires full sun, really intense sunlight, this is the garden where I put it. Things like my main tomatoes are growing over here, and then my peppers, carrots, things that are going to require some really good, strong sunlight to get the best production, this is where they go. In this bed, this 4-foot by 4-foot bed, in here I'm growing a tomato called German Johnson tomato. And I actually have more than that growing in here. I have a couple onions, and I had a potato growing right here. The potato was doing really, really good until German Johnson got going. Now, German Johnson is supposed to be this large, juicy, old-fashioned flavored beefsteak tomato. That's what I read. I heard about it. I've never grown it before. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to give it a shot. I started it inside early. I started it months and months and months ago inside in a little cup, and started from seed. It grew. It wasn't really doing that good. I'm used to growing a tomato called Boxcar Willie. That's a good old-fashioned, not a huge beefsteak tomato, more like a slicing table tomato. And my mouth's starting to water because I'm thinking about it. It has old-fashioned acidic tomato flavor, and that's what I really like. I'm not really a fan of sweet tomatoes except for cherry tomatoes. Now this one, it wasn't as robust as Boxcar Willie. Boxcar Willie grows so fast. It's so healthy. It doesn't have the blight problems, any of that. It was really my go-to tomato. I wanted to try something different in addition to Boxcar Willie. So I started this one, and it wasn't really putting out suckers like I remember Boxcar Willie doing. I thought, well, that kind of blows. I really didn't have much confidence in it, and I almost tossed it out. But I thought, you know what? I went this far with it. It has a couple branches. I'll go ahead and bury it over here. So I planted it over in that side, assuming it's not going to get that big because it looks kind of puny. So I planted all this other stuff here. Well, just when I think I have everything figured out, I run into a twist. But it's a good twist. This thing started putting out its roots. Now I bury them deep. That's the method that I use. I dig a really deep hole. I plant them as far down as I can dig a hole, and then I just have the tops growing. So this tomato plant was from the bottom of the container to the top was about this tall. Once I planted it out here, it was just these little teeny tiny plants. So you can imagine the main root system was way down at the bottom, and then it was spread out. So all of those side branches were putting down roots very, very slowly. It took a while, and this is when we had our frost days come in, and I had to cover it with a bucket, and it looked really puny, and it looked like it was dying. So I thought, I'll just forget about it, and if I get a tomato, I'm lucky. It all of a sudden went crazy. The root system started going down, spreading out, the compost kicked in, and this is what I have. This is all one plant, one seed, and it's putting out flowers all over the place. Like, and you know what's really weird? It's not just putting out one flower here, one flower there. It almost has the pattern of Rapunzel. It's like a cross between Rapunzel and a regular beefsteak. It's putting out multiple, like 5 or 6 flowers in each cluster. And these are supposed to be large beefsteaks, so I might be in for an Armageddon of tomatoes. I don't know. I know nothing about this. One thing I wanted to tell you, though, is when you're see, I don't support this with cages or anything like that. I call it free-range tomatoes. I let them just sprawl out. And that's the natural pattern of a tomato. A lot of gardeners don't go with this, so that's why I'm kind of on the outside of the gardening community. A lot of gardeners have one way of doing things, and they follow that strict path. I kind of dance to a different drummer. I let them sprawl out, which allows the tomato to put out endless suckers, and then they grow up, they fall down, they put out more suckers, and what happens is tomatoes start appearing all over the place. And I did this last year. I got 20 gallons of tomato out of Boxcar Willie over right there by your feet. I don't assume I'm going to get that many, but this sprawl and conquer method, it seems to be working for German Johnson. What you want to do is, if you're going to have your tomatoes growing, especially right now when it starts getting warmer and more humid, get in there with your scissors and some of these leaf branches, not at the top, but down there at ground level. See, one of the problems that we have is what's called early blight, which is a fungal issue. It's not a game ender, but what happens is the moisture is down there on the soil and the leaves are down there, and that is a breeding ground for fungus, and it will attack your leaves. You'll get like the little yellow and spots, they turn brown, and the whole leaf stem ends up turning yellow. That's early blight. Snip that off, throw it out of your garden, not a problem at all. And also keep these lower leaves pruned out, because they don't need all of those lower leaves. Prune them out, let some airflow get in there, and that way you'll cut down your early blight almost to none. These plants hardly have any early blight at all, and that's because I go in there and I snip all the lower leaf sections out, so it's, you could just see bare stems flowing through there, and then you have the plant coming up like this. And that way you have less blight, healthier plants, not a problem at all. Another thing people mention is that you don't want to have your tomatoes touching the soil. I've had that happen, and I've never had an issue. And I think that has to do with healthy soil. I take care of the soil, which takes care of my plants. So I would say I'm lucky, but I've been doing this for decades and never had an issue. So it can't just be luck. It has probably has something to do with the soil is healthy. If you're not taking good care of your soil is not going to take good care of you. So anyway, that's my German Johnson, and it's starting to get little tiny tomatoes. Not really worth showing, but it has a couple of them about that big. Now, one of the things that really kind of surprised me was I mentioned that I was growing a Boxcar Willie. Boxcar Willie, I brought out here, you saw it on an earlier program, it was my huge disappointment. I planted it over here to your left in the bed, and it died. It just died. We had, it just went through a lot of stress, and the frost came through, the cold, and it just couldn't hold on. And before I even planted it, the winds broke the branches, and when I was moving it, I broke the branches. It was just a catastrophe. It was just the most horrible thing. I can't even put it into words. I'm stumbling over words. And so I planted it. It had one little shoot come up, and that little shoot tried, and then just dropped dead. It was really kind of sad. So what I did was, remember, I had those two little cups, my little Dixie cup garden. I had the Boxcar Willie inside, and I had this cup of tomato plant that I had planted inside, and it grew a couple little anemic-looking shoots. I took those, and I rooted them in cups. And they rooted, but they were just these little tiny plants. I brought those out here as a last-ditch effort. It had rained so heavily. I dug a hole, and as soon as I got 6 inches down, it filled with water. And I thought, oh, this is sucky. So I just threw it in there, threw dirt on it, walked away. I thought, it's not going to work. I am constantly wrong. Take a look at how wrong I was. Just wow. This is incredible. Now, for those of you who don't understand, I planted one seed, planted Boxcar Willie. This was earlier in the spring, late winter, and it grew up inside. I took a clipping off and put it into a cup and grew a little cup plant. And the mother plant I brought out here, I planted in the garden. That's the one that died that I just told you about. And then the cup plant I planted into another pot inside, and it grew two little shoots. Those ones I put into cups, and then I brought those cups and I planted them out here. So these are two plants that are from the mother plant. And so they were laid in the mud. This was just mud down here. It was a mud hole. And they survived it. They survived it. Their root system sent down roots. It dried out over here, and now they're growing. And you go in here, and you can see all kinds of little clusters of flowers all over the place. And it's starting to send out suckers. It's spreading. I got a feeling I'm going to have a bumper crop of boxcar willy. Yes, it's late. It's got a late start going, but you know what? I got a feeling I'm going to do some catching up here. And hey, little R, how you doing? No, apparently he's doing a little too well to give us any attention. I think that pretty much does it for today. Yeah, I'm a happy gardener. Every day I come down here, there's something new growing. This is that time of year where once it rains, you come out the next day and it just explodes. And this is the part of the year where the roots in this garden particularly, are starting to really get down and find that compost, and it's starting to supercharge the garden. It's just nuts. Next episode, I want to bring you out here again. So wear a t-shirt. It's going to be a little bit warm next week. I want to show you the carrots. I want to show you the tomatillo plant. I planted a tomatillo over here. And I have some onion craziness going on here. The onions, you just got to see the onions. It just makes me laugh when I look at the onions. You're going to have to wait till next week. But anyway, thank you for joining me. If you have any questions concerning your tomatoes, oh, by the way, I will show you the peppers as well. And I have a short story to tell about the peppers next week. You're going to love this. You're going to love this. It will give you some hope for your peppers. So join me next week out here at the garden. Until then, me and the gang, we're going to head on inside and cool down. It's starting to get a little bit warm right now. But thanks for joining me. I really do appreciate it. Tiki! Come on, Tiki. Hey, Cheeto. You waited for me, didn't you? Yes, you did. You want to go inside? Oh, of course you do. I don't know where the heck Tiny R is. Well, he'll find his way back. Come on. You're so happy.